I'm Kurt Ransohoff. I'm the CEO and the Chief Medical Officer here at Sansum Clinic. And before we get started, I should just mention that I'm an internist and not a surgeon. To the doctors here, I think they know what the difference is. To the rest of you, maybe I'll just tell a brief story that actually just happened yesterday. I saw a patient in the office, and she had fallen the day before, and she was limping and obviously in pain, and I got an x-ray, and she had a hip fracture. And so I called the orthopedic surgeon, and I said, and talked with him, and then I went back in the room, and she said, well, what do I need? And I said, you need a surgeon. And then I realized, actually, what I was really saying was, I need a surgeon. And I think for all of us who are not surgeons, we've all said that many, many times. And really, just before going on, I just want to thank my surgical colleagues for all of the work they've done. So thank you. And as I've said before, I also want to thank them for letting an internist say anything at a surgical lecture. So I'd really like to welcome you all to Sansum Clinic's Visiting Professor of Surgery Lecture. It's part of the Surgical Academic Week, and it's really a distinct honor to have a physician of the highest caliber, and that is Dr. Keith Lillemoe. Dr. Lillemoe is a world-renowned general surgeon who specializes in gastrointestinal, pancreatic, and biliary surgery, and he is the Surgeon-in-Chief of the Department of Surgery at Massachusetts General Hospital. He follows three previous visiting professors. In 2012, we had Dr. John Cameron, who was also a pancreatic surgeon from Johns Hopkins, with whom I believe Dr. Lillemoe worked for a number of years. We had Dr. Hiram Polk from the University of Louisville in 2013. And then finally, last year, we had a West Coast doctor, and that was Dr. Julianne Freischlag. Although that was cheating a little bit, because she was actually at Johns Hopkins when we asked her to come. And she became the dean of the medical school at UC Davis right before she gave her lecture. So tonight's lecture and this week's educational activities, which started on Monday, have been made possible by the generous support of donors, including patients at the clinic and many non-patients, Sansum Clinic trustees and staff, community individual doctors, a number of whom are here today, and we welcome you and we thank you for your support. Physician groups and corporate contributors. We want to also recognize, I don't think Ron Wirtz is here, but Ron and Cottage Health System for again being the title sponsor, and we really are happy to be able to work together on this project. The visiting professor educational program was really started by Dr. Latimer, and it has been his vision to advance surgical education opportunities for community practicing physicians, as well as the surgical residents at Cottage Hospital. And it is really his vision that has allowed this program to take flight. So thank you so much, Ron, for that. A special thanks also to the Cottage Hospital full-time surgical faculty, Dr. Kaminsky and Dr. Govan particularly, without whom this program would just not be possible. So before I turn the program over to Dr. Latimer, I'd just like to acknowledge a few guests in the audience this evening. From Sansum Clinic Board of Trustees, we had Vicki Hazard, our board chair, but she had to leave. We have Julie McGovern, Tom Fly, and Jim McNamara, also an internist, I might add. I think with us from the Cancer Foundation, we have Art Maravich, and I think Steve McHugh may also be here. And from Cottage Hospital, we have Bob Norris, the board chair, so thank you for coming. So again, thank you all for coming, and let me introduce a real surgeon, Dr. Latimer.
First of all, thank you to everyone for coming. We're going to see if our audio-visual will work. I'm going to stand to the side because I think you can probably hear me without the microphone. Obviously, we need to thank a lot of people, and Kurt has done that. But I want to thank my partners, who I worked with for many, many years. This would not exist without them, and they took care of my patients and vice versa for years. Cottage Hospital is a supporter of this program, and the surgical residency teaching faculty, which is Dr. Galvin, who was mentioned, and Dr. Kaminsky. And then I do have to mention our director of philanthropy, who worked quite hard and takes care of all of the logistics and details. And then Cynthia Stoddard, who is also, and Nancy Mastropian, who are the same type of people at Cottage and do all the details there. And then I want to thank friends, and I stole this last year and will steal it again. Viewers like you or donors like you, our program would not exist without you all, and we are always welcoming more support if one wants to do that. The program is open for that. I'm just going to run through our previous professors of surgery. Dr. John Cameron was our first. I would call him the godfather of this program. After his visit here, sent out the word that this was not a bad venue to come to. I'm going to back up for just a minute. You'll remember Dr. Cameron gave us the history of Halsted, his relationship with Richard Hall, who was the first surgeon at Cottage Hospital. Dr. Halsted and Dr. Hall had a little problem with cocaine, and Dr. Hall came out here to get off the drug and started the hospital. Basically, he was a professor of surgery, the first surgeon in Santa Barbara, and as I remember, he also brought the first radiology machine to Santa Barbara. And unfortunately, Dr. Hall died of appendicitis in Santa Barbara because there was no surgeon around to take care of him. Our second visiting professor was the, I would say, the bodacious and somewhat pugilistic Arthur Pope. He was stimulatory, and he gave a very nice talk on horse racing and the intricacies and the, one would say, the graft that goes on in professional horse racing. Our third professor of surgery was Julianne Freischlag. I would say she was the lady who led us down the lanes of leadership, because that was her area of expertise, and she gave quite a nice presentation. Obviously, the female residents loved her, spent a lot of time with her, and she was really very, very thoughtful and gave a lot to the program. And this is a picture of Keith, and I'm going to expound a little bit more on that, but Keith had no problem getting here. I was worried if he was going to make it. And the first thing he had to do was he had to dig his way out of the house. It was 38 degrees high and 25 degrees low. And I heard today that there's still 43 inches of snow on the ground there. So he's probably going to want to stay another week or two. I don't know if he can afford it, but we'll try. He did pretty well with the yard, getting his walk done, but then realized he put all the snow on top of the car. And it's nice to be ahead of a department, because he called a couple of his residents and said, "Come and help me get out." And after a while, they said, "Dr. Lillemoe, we just can't do that. Don't you have a backup plan?" And he did. He thought that Cheryl wouldn't mind going to the airport. This is kind of the Uber of Boston. In the meantime, he calls out, and they get Air Force, no, Harvard, my plane is getting ready for him to take off. Now, as soon as the rest heard that the chief was leaving, they decided, while the cat's away, the residents will hug. So they were a little thrilled that they were going to have some time to enjoy the snow. They had an uneventful flight until they got to L.A. And I think when they saw this, they thought that maybe snow was better. I'm not sure. But they made it up. But we have backup plans, too. So we have a safety. Now, some people say she looks like Drew. I don't think she looks a lot like Drew. But I can tell you that both of them do miracles. And so we asked her to intercede for us, see if we can provide something for them that was kind of nice. And lo and behold, she provided a fairly nice sunset. But she didn't. We asked her to, can't you give them some nice accommodations? Well, the Sansum Castle wasn't there. We tried, but it was booked. So we had to settle on the Biltmore. It turned out to be okay. Now, they go out and work hard, they prep. This is how they study. And Keith had an opportunity to see how well trained they are and how versed they are in surfing and volleyball. And I want to now just give you his resume. This is, I would say, is not too shabby. There's not much that Keith hasn't done, but just to point out, he's the editor of the Annals of Surgery. That's not Annals of Surgery, that's Annals of Surgery. And that is the main surgical journal that all surgeons look to. If they could ever get published, that would be brilliant, an achievement. But they look to it for study. So I've asked him to talk not so much about medicine and surgery and pancreatic cancers and things like that, because he's done that all week. And he's given a wonderful series of lectures to the medical staff, the surgical staff, and the residents have had a great time interacting with him. So it's now I will turn the podium over to our guest speaker, and I'll turn over that to him also.
Well, thank you very much, Ron, for that very generous and introduction. It was a lot of fun to relive some of my time in Boston. This has been a great week. I thank so much to Ron. I thank Drew. Her organization of this entire event has been fantastic. I thank the faculty and the residents for making it a really pleasant experience for Cheryl and I, and whoever took care of the weather, they did a perfect job. So we're very pleased to be here. I'm a little nervous. My wife doesn't hear me speak very often, and so and this isn't a topic, you know, I'm very comfortable talking about the pancreas and other things. I've got far too many slides, and truthfully, I may actually wander over here so I can see them a little bit better, but I'm going to go through them quickly because I'd like to leave some opportunity for discussion. And I know there is a lot of doctors in the audience, and so hopefully this isn't too focused on the physician side of it, and it has some focus on the patient side of it. I start out with a few disclosures like we have to do. First of all, I'm apolitical, so if I make any comments related to Romney Care, Obamacare, it shouldn't have a political motive. Number two, I'm not a huge, not very knowledgeable about this topic, and I'm certainly not knowledgeable about healthcare on the West Coast, but being embedded in Boston, I certainly have gathered knowledge over the last 4 years. my opinions represent those of a physician, and perhaps not of a patient or someone in the community, but I do think that I can provide the views, at least of a surgeon, as how we view what's happening. And finally, I'm not actually from Boston. I'm a transplant from the Midwest, and I've only been at the Commonwealth of Massachusetts for about 4 years. So just like Ron, I'd like to share with you a little bit of the experience. You may recognize this. This, I know there are several people from Brookline and Boston, and some people who have family still living there, so you've heard these stories. There are a few I'd like to share, and I apologize if some of these are repetitious from my earlier talks. Again, this is Marlborough Street, where Tom Brady used to live. I'm sure they had no trouble getting him out of there. Boston is so dependent on public transportation, so these are people who are being moved from the T that is stopped because of the snow to buses that will try to get them to work. It's been a real disaster. They've had to actually close the MGH on a couple of days, which costs us roughly $10 million a day when that happens because the T is closed. So it's been a big financial hit, really, for a lot of organizations. It also cost the person who runs the T their job. That person got fired by the new new governor a few weeks ago. This is the home of the world champion Patriots. I'm not a Patriots fan, nor am I a Red Sox fan, but this is where the Patriots play. This will be opening day here in less than a month, where the Red Sox will be playing. So the bottom line is there's a lot of a digging out that has to take place in it's there on the left. Yeah. And, we have our winter sports. Obviously, there's climbing your house to clean off your roof that is now leaking and with these huge ice sickles hanging down. of those of you who want to try to bike on the very narrow roads and sidewalks. But the new resort in Massachusetts is the Snow Farm. So this is a snow farm. So Massachusetts, as you know, is sort of locked in because they have the ocean on one side, and obviously as it expands out, there's more and more people and less space. So you can't just push your snow into the Boston Harbor or the Charles River. You have to truck it out. So if you can look at this and see the size of this snow mountain that has been built with snow that has been moved out to a snow farm compared to the caterpillars and the bulldozers there. So I'm sure that the skiing opportunities there are probably fantastic. So, and again, they even have some moguls there, I think, that you can work your way around. So this is, why I've had such a great week in Santa Barbara. And I'm sorry that you didn't get a little bit more moisture yesterday, but we were happy to give you an afternoon where it was a little cooler and a little precipitation. So I came to Mass General 4 years ago, and that was about a couple years after really Romney Care, as it likes to be called, was brought into play. And truthfully, it was probably a good thing for Massachusetts, because Massachusetts is obviously a fairly liberal state. They had a lot of things in place that made it work. And the biggest advantage, I think, for Romney Care or the health care that was started in Massachusetts under Governor Romney was that it has really looked after those people who are uninsured. And clearly in Massachusetts, access is not a problem. Now that helps that we have more doctors than you can shake a stick at, but clearly there are very few people who are uninsured in the state of Massachusetts, which I think is a good thing. And they were able to pay for it through existing funds. It has not been translated particularly to the taxpayers as of yet, although we certainly get hit in a lot of different ways. But it is really good in terms of access, and that's been a very positive thing. Problem is they've had to add to it, and I'll talk about that a little bit later. But it, now the state and some of the aspects of the state feels that it's their job now to really regulate the costs, which has been the real challenge for our organization. But as it was presented, I think the healthcare reform in Massachusetts has been a very positive thing. Of course, Massachusetts is just one state in the union, and I think you're all aware of the challenges that existed for healthcare all through the United States, and the fact that the costs are clearly a thing of concern. You've seen these charts in many speakers in many different venues, and I'm not going to focus too much of them. But the bottom line is that the costs have continued to rise, and most of those costs are carried not by the government, but are transmitted on to the various insurance payers who supplement the cost of delivery of care for Medicare, Medicaid, and the uninsured. Chronic disease, as people live longer, as well as new technology. I gave a talk the other day about pancreatic cancer and some of the great innovative chemotherapy combinations that we now offer, but the fact that they cost about $20,000 a month to what they add is certainly a problem. So as technology such as robotic technology, newer drug to treat hepatitis C, which is fantastic, but is driving some of the insurers in Massachusetts almost to go broke because of the cost of it. They're great, but obviously the technology advancements are a significant problem. So President Obama, through the coalition that he was able to build in Congress, was able to get the Health Care Act passed. It is a landmark piece of legislation, but obviously it is a complex piece of legislation. And the one theme throughout this entire bill is it all comes down to the Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare, Health and Human Services, I'm sorry, that all these, this maze leads to one decision. And so many of the lines in this bill start out, the Secretary will determine. So there's a lot of building that has to go on in this program, and a lot yet to be determined. It obviously had its challenges. Those challenges have been survived at least some rounds in the courts, including the Supreme Court has upheld. But the states continue to fight it, and there's a number of lawsuits that are still pending at various state levels to inhibit the process. Politically, as we all know, there's been a change in the leadership of Congress at both houses now. And truthfully, whether there will be action to try to dilute or make changes with the new Republican leadership in Congress, and whether it'll be enough to override a veto is certainly, again, I'm trying to stay apolitical, but I think you might say that there are a lot of challenges still ahead. So this is the implementation timetable, and obviously, as you can see, we're there. I mean, a lot of the steps that have come along the way have been good. As someone who had a daughter who went to medical school, I was able to keep her on my home family health insurance throughout medical school, well past the ages when they would cut off. I think everybody believes that the coverage that's provided for pre-existing condition has been a good thing. And the emphasis that has really focused on quality and safety, and including the establishment of the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute that looks at quality and safety, have all been very positive aspects of Obamacare. I think, unfortunately, we're now coming to the point where we're having to pay for it. They were very smart as how they rolled these things out. A lot of what was rolled out was kind of like mom and apple pie and very positive. But now the challenges are coming, and clearly some of the things that seemed right about quality and safety are now coming to be landing on the laps of the physicians, on the hospitals, and to some extent the insurers as well. This is so looking at the response from the providers, that is both the physicians and the hospitals, there have been a lot of reactions that have come into play. And this is, again, one of the first slides, I think, that really I try to accent what goes on the East Coast versus the West Coast. And again, I've picked Ron's brains and some of the other doctors about how practice exists here. I was fortunate enough to visit Stanford a few months ago as a consultant to one of their search processes and learned a little bit about it. But I honestly do think we are, unfortunately, ahead of the curve. Our insurance payers are doing a very tight job of trying to control what hospitals patients go to. My hospital is obviously viewed as an academic medical center. It's a high-cost hospital. And truthfully, the out-of-cost payments for someone who wants to elect to come to the Massachusetts General Hospital is prohibitive for a lot of people to want to come there. There have been shifts of responsibility and risk to the providers. These have been through global payments, through shared saving processes. I'll talk a little bit about ACOs. Coming down the line are bundled payments. And then the entire episodic management that has really changed the marketplace in which we deal. With the focus is now on the primary care providers with the reduced hospital use and truthfully, some of the programs that are in existence actually pay for not use. And if you think, well, gee, what's the difference between this and the capitation and the managed care from the days when Hillary was speaking about those? But still, I honestly think that we've moved there, but there are a few things that are a little bit better as we're now 20 years later. My concern as a surgeon, I've already voiced that, limited access. It used to be in Massachusetts that if you wanted to come to a hospital, you could pretty much choose to do it. Whether you're part of a tiered insurance product that tells you it'll cost you more out of pocket. As a surgeon, my concerns really center around, as I mentioned, the tiered insurance products, the limited networks. If you belong to a Leahy Clinic network as opposed to a partners network, whether you're able to go. And then I'll go to one hospital or three to move from place to place. I'll talk a bit about the differences between AQC and ACO programs. And then the threat on surgical reimbursement. Most of us have grown up through the sort of eat what you kill, pay for what you do sort of process, where volume has actually driven surgeon reimbursement or physician specialty reimbursement. Now, again, they're tying in pay for performance as well as the potential for bundled payments. So these are the concerns, and I know there's about a 50-50 split between physicians in here as well as lay people, but certainly from our perspective, this is something we live with. So the goal is to provide the highest quality patient care in a patient-centered, friendly manner.
You know, we want to demonstrate and exhibit the highest of quality. We want to decrease costs and want to provide savings to the various producers. Purchasers, our approach is obviously to work to improve quality. When I came to Stanford as a consultant, I was shocked that, there was really no officer for quality and safety within the Department of Surgery. That all centers around reducing costs, redesigning patient care, and in many cases looking for, less a need for patients to come into the hospital, but also trying to improve access. The AQC programs are those programs that, exist with the private insurance companies, and, at least in, Massachusetts, these are a part of just about every program. Certainly all our contracts, as they're renegotiated with the major payers, have to have a major quality component within it. It's a new form of capitation. It is the alternative for fee-for-service. And it combines a sort of a per-patient global payment within the significant performance incentives on the quality measures. So not only do you have to limit the access, or not the access, but the, use of services, but the services you use have to be directly applied from a, quality perspective. And this slide's a little bit old, but it still shows how this has taken off over the last few years with the number of, PCPs that are involved in these programs, as well as the numbers of members of most of the HMOs. ACOs are, sort of the AQC for the Medicare and Medicaid. The first ACO began shortly after I arrived in Boston. It's called the Pioneer ACO. This was offered to healthcare organizations throughout the entire country. It was only signed up for initially by 32 healthcare systems. It did involve 18 states and 860,000 Medicare beneficiaries. But to tell you how it is politically distributed, only one organization was below the Mason-Dixon line, and, five were in Massachusetts. So that tells you we are clearly ahead of the curve. What is an ACO? It is clearly involves the Medicare and Medicaid population, but it's an organization of healthcare providers that agrees to be accountable for the quality, cost, and overall care of the Medicare beneficiaries who are enrolled in this program. An ACO meets its performance standards and has savings, the money will come to them. If they exceed the expenditures that are associated with it, or if their performance standards do not meet that, then they get underpaid. And clearly, again, I know there's a lot of things going on here in Santa Barbara between the clinic as well as the Cottage Hospital, but it really is a reason for alignment of the physicians and the health systems, because if you're not aligned, it is very difficult to make any of these programs work, whether they be AQCs or the ACOs. Again, how do they control the referrals? They look for hospitals that can offer them lower fees. So as a high-cost hospital, we have the threat of people who within our ACO looking to send their patients outside of our own system to other hospitals that are viewed as, cheaper. Again, the patients sometimes get caught in the middle. They've been going to the MGH or the Brigham Hospital for years. Now they're being directed to the cheaper partners within our, system. So again, it is very threatening to the academic medical centers. Is it capitation? Well, in some ways it is. It's basically the same playbook. Closed network, budget-based risk, leading to provider sensitivity, restriction of choice, and it will still have some backlash. But there is some improvements over it. Number one, it's a slower process. They started out with not cuts, but with caps. The economy is a little less threatening than it was when this was first brought out. The government is more active with the process. We have better IT and better data, which helps us with the population management. Again, it is tried to really not direct it at the individual primary care physician. I do know we have a few PCPs here. The previous threats were really based on the individual physician. Now it's to the entire group. And again, it rewards the network for meeting their targets. So the money comes back to the entire system and can get spread out across the entire system, both to the hospitals and the physicians. And again, the entire burden does not get thrown on the primary care docs. The specialists have to be involved and be accountable as well. When I say partners, that's our health system in Massachusetts 25 years ago, the Brigham, the MGH, and a few other hospitals came together to form the Partners Healthcare System. It's a little bit about our system, which again is very well aligned between the physicians of all these organizations, as well as the academic and the community health systems. This is a little bit about how our system works. Our acute hospital revenue, 80% comes from Eastern Massachusetts, the rest comes from outside of that area. But of that, at least 40% appears to be associated with our own network. So these are our physicians who are trying to manage the patients. So it's a little bit like driving your car with one foot on the accelerator and one foot on the brake. We are trying to limit the growth and the spending on this group, but also trying to expand our opportunities to grow out of state and out of network. Unfortunately, however, there's, as I mentioned, there's five other organizations in the state that are trying to do the same thing, and dealing with partners is really one of the challenges. So one of the key elements of what we've done with respect to our ACO is we've had a total alignment of all of our hospitals, of all of our various physicians group, including PCHE, which is again the primary care network expanded throughout, a total of almost 700 physicians in primary care scattered through all the different health systems, about 50,000 beneficiaries. We do get a chance to opt out, but we've been successful thus far and continued. As I mentioned before, the first Pioneer ACO, 32 organizations nationally. As you can see, five were in the state of Massachusetts, in which Partners was the largest. Now, we've had some success. So why did we choose to do this? This was elective at that time. And again, I'm not sure whether this community has gone into that, but we've actually had some success. So this was looking at the healthcare management of patients. And what we realized is that 10% of the population of patients accounts for about two-thirds of the spending. And these are roughly patients who have multiple comorbidities, congestive heart failure, chronic lung disease, cardiac disease, diabetes, psychiatric diseases. And this is your typical MGH enrollee if you look at the table with all the medications that this young lady takes. But again, we tried it with a pilot project. We validated the ability to do this and were successful. And this was a demonstration project that we completed. 87% of our eligible enrollees or eligible beneficiaries enrolled. It was quite successful, actually. The return on savings was about 7%, net savings, 12% across the board. And it really shows, and this was actually published in the New England Journal of Medicine, it actually shows that if this is done well, that if you can manage these patients with the complex comorbidities, there is money to be saved. So this has now been expanded throughout, this was one of multiple pilots that were done around the country at this time. I won't go through all the names here, but these are multiple organizations who attempted a pilot. And without being a statistician, what's important is that your error bars are on either side of this break-even line. And so the only organization that actually showed success in doing this was the Massachusetts General Hospital. And I give credit, we have some very, very bright individuals. This is actually my former state of the University of Maryland. As you can see, the wide range and where they are over at that extent. So it is very complicated. I see if I see any names from California on there, probably don't. But the bottom line is if you have the right people calling the shots and the right system in place, it can work. So that was one of the things that pushed us to participate. So where does this fall in for us as the physicians? Well, this is a complex process of providing high-value care. It involves the primary care docs, it involves the specialty docs, it involves the hospitals. It has to involve access to care, redesign of care, and then measurement of your outcomes. And the two in the middle, both shared decision-making and appropriateness, really is something myself as a surgeon had are two words or two phrases that have really been added to my vocabulary when I came to Boston. Typically in the past, again, if I made the diagnosis, I always send it to a urologist. You go to a barber, you get a haircut, everything, if you're a hammer, everything's a nail. But now, again, the goal is to really try to direct patients into their participating in the decision-making process to all the various options, and then looking back to see what the patient-reported outcomes are related to the therapies. So moving on, the other aspect of concerns for us as surgeons has been the pay-for-performance. And again, this started out with just simply reporting. If one showed that they were doing various things, things such as the skip measures, these were safety items that were determined to be important, the proper starting of antibiotics, the removal of urinary catheters, a number of things that were all, it started out by simply saying that if you were reporting your outcomes, you receive some recognition and payment. Now, of course, they've all been transmitted into, if you're not doing these things, they actually can be withholding from the reimbursement. So again, efficiency, the goals were at efficiency, for quality, and improving the infrastructure. Fortunately, with new tools like computerized physician order entry, better electronic medical record, which was mandated again by Obamacare, and safety system implementation are really the factors. And I would guess that of all the words now I talk about in terms of cure and outcomes and infections and length of stay and safety, the one terms that we probably speak of most as a group, you're spilling your wine there, man. the terms quality and safety just continue to be pushed on all levels because we know that that's where our performance is coming. So it's trying to deal with the chasm that exists between what healthcare is and what it should be. Certainly our goal is to provide better care so patients have better outcomes, better quality of life. If we do that in a cost-efficient fashion, there will be a savings for the payers. And again, by doing this, if we're able to make sure that by shortening length of stay and other things, it allows more access to patients, I think it's a win for everyone. And as I said, CMS, who at least governs the Medicare payments, is becoming a very important part of this. As I said, the transition from pay-for-reporting to pay-for-performance is upon us now as they're looking at our performances in past years and paying us now accordingly. And this just puts into perspective the magnitude. I don't even know what hospital this is, but these were the various programs that existed. Quality reporting, value-based purchasing, hospital-acquired conditions, reducing readmissions, meaningful use. These were the years of implementation. These are the payment mechanisms. These are the risks. And for this one hospital in New England, over the course of this entire period of time, it's close to $150 million, which is at risk. So again, it is catching our attention very, very dramatically. There are strengths that if we as an organization can meet our targets, we have a benefit. Most of our physicians in our organization are employed physicians, so that works out reasonably well. There's a developed series of important measures and expertise in how to manage these targets. And again, we have an excellent system of both electronic medical record, e-prescribing that has helped us move into these new steps. It has unfortunately had only a modest effect on quality and safety. There's still a lot of burden on the PCPs. Most of the targets are not relevant to most of our physicians. And there's a lag time. Again, what you did in 2013 is now affecting how you're paid in 2015. So again, the benefit of a big organization that's closely aligned with the hospital is our physicians organization has built in a quality incentive program. By meeting certain targets, there's actually direct cash that goes to our physicians. So again, although the pay-for-performance, again, for things like medical reconciliation and things like that, seems small to the individual patient or individual physician, it is big time for the hospital. And they've been able to find a way to direct it to us through specific quality improvement programs. What about, the value-based modifiers within CMS, again, as I said, they're moving forward, looking back at what we've done in the past and how we're paid in the future. It's up to about 10 to 20% now of our payments. It's designed to be budget neutral. That is, there'll be winners and losers. And so if you're on the winning side, Again, you'll see a 10 to 20% increase. If you're on the losing side, you have the risk of a 10 to 20% loss. Well, what about bundled payments? Well, bundled payments is the concept of whatever disease might be taken care of, whether it's a fractured hip, it's an MI, whether it's a cancer of type, that all the costs between the physicians for diagnosis, for treatment, for surgery, for inpatient care can all be bundled together. There are a number of payment opportunities out there. There are four models that are in play. Fortunately, none of them have yet been applied to my specialty. Transplant has been around for a long time. Cardiac surgery and orthopedic surgery are moving in those directions. And I'm very sure that cancer will be the next, because obviously the much of the costs that are associated with care are related to cancer care. So how are we managing this within our system? Again, the Partners Health System. Again, we have this pressure to reduce the trend. We've gone at it from three-pronged attack. We're investing in the patient population management infrastructure. We're working on internal performance framework and trying to build network affiliations. Again, the relationship between the doctors and the physicians are important to try to be able to continue to drive these costs down to near the GDP. It has been published, the man's name in the middle there. This is the president of the Reagan, this is the president of the MJs, this is the guy who does all the work, a guy named Tim Ferriss, who's really a brilliant young man who has a great handle of patient management, population management. And again, I think from the hospital administrative perspective is something that would certainly be worth reading. We have challenges. The bigger the network, probably the better it might be. The more patients you control, the more you can distribute those costs across the population. Unfortunately, in Eastern Massachusetts, we have two enemies. One is the government, and two is the Boston Globe. These are two headlines that I just pulled from the last couple months, without going into detail, and I know some of you still do have MGH connections. Partners did try to acquire a couple of hospitals. And of course, we have both the Justice Department and the State Attorney General going after us. One of the more recent healthcare implementations is a health policy commission headed by Stuart Altman, who has to approve any acquisition. And of course, they have hammered everything that we've tried to do. And so between them and then the State Attorney General, who is running for governor, we were sort of caught in the middle, and of course the Boston Globe likes to flame those fires. So what has unfortunately happened is because of both of these, our attempt to acquire a couple of these hospitals were rejected by a Massachusetts Supreme Court, and we're back to square one. Now fortunately, a casualty of this was the head of Partners, who wasn't politically savvy, although he was a psychiatrist, has decided to go work for Partners in Health International. And our former chief of cardiac surgery, who's a great guy, and I think a friend of Tom, has gotten moved up into that position. He's a great guy, very healthy, or very health conscious, very politically conscious, and hopefully we'll have a better relationship with these two organizations. Now, if you think it's bad living in Massachusetts, I do have to say that it's worse living in Maryland. So the two states that I've spent much of my life have been Massachusetts, now in Maryland. Maryland has this thing called the HSCRC, which it basically is worked very well for a number of years. It totally restricts the profits that are related to a hospital. And again, as I lament with my friends and colleagues back at Johns Hopkins and the University of Maryland, it really, in one way, it protects hospitals from losses, but on the other hand, it protects really from growth. And that's why, frankly, the entire strategy for Johns Hopkins medicine is all about international growth. They want to become the Cleveland Clinic or the Mayo Clinic because of their location on the East Coast for growing, because the opportunities to have any profits in Maryland are really tightly limited by this. And our hospitals continue to do well. We continue to face challenges, but I honestly think we have bright leaders, and it's an exciting time to try to figure these things out. So I'd just like to talk a little bit about one program that we've brought into play that may affect many of you, either as a provider or as a patient. And it's called PROE. And again, many of you probably have radiology order entering or order entry systems. So this is procedure order entry, and its association with PROMs, with patient-reported outcome measures, and again, the shared decision-making and customized risk and education. So again, our hope is if we can't necessarily drive these decisions based on cost, because we know we will always be a bit more expensive, is that we will try to drive patients because they realize that words such as appropriateness and the appropriate understanding of the risks and benefits associated with procedures will be well defined, as well as our focus on really the patient-reported outcomes. It's one thing for me to report outcomes, it's another thing for you after a hernia repair, you after a hip replacement. What are your outcomes as how you perceive them? And I'm going to walk you through the system of how an idealized patient journey is. First of all, we see the patient. We assess how they view their physical condition. We do appropriateness criteria measurement. We refer to a patient, refer to the specialist, whether it be a general surgeon, a bariatric surgeon, a cardiac surgeon, or a vascular surgeon. The patient's information is put into a system. The patients are informed of the various alternatives to the process. They get their own personalized risk forms. And again, I'll show you a few examples of those. So our goal, of course, is to maintain health status, to improve the process of recovery, and sustain health. So again, the word appropriateness, I've used that several times during my talks with the residents. The focus is again, improving the patient care, do the right thing. Just because I can do a procedure, just because I can do a study, is it the right thing to do for the patients? If we don't overuse, we have a chance of lowering costs. By doing that, we can improve our administrative efficiency, and as well as, again, meet our regulatory requirements, as well as reporting our appropriateness to some of the regulatory agencies that we deal with. It helps us to deal with, again, legislative mandates. And again, we want to let the patients know of our efforts to provide procedures only that are appropriate to the benefit of their care. This is a bit repetitious, and so I'll skip over this to move into how this system works. So this is an evaluation that one of our vascular surgeons is doing with a patient with carotid stenosis. For the non-medical people, this is a narrowing of the carotid artery. It is treatable with the surgical. First of all, it's treatable medically, it's treatable surgically, and it's treatable endoscopically. So the surgeon does their evaluation. Is the patient symptomatic? What is the level of narrowing? What are the procedural related risks? What is the appropriate medical therapy that the patient may or may not be on? There are a number of questions that we have to answer, such as the progression of the disease and have they had strokes. We answer these questions, again, more about the risk of the procedure. Does the patient have a risk of stroke? Do they have atrial fibrillation? Risk of various other procedures that may complicate a surgical procedure. What spits out at the end is, again, sort of the red, green, or yellow appropriate for the various management. So again, in our language, green is always good. That means go. It provides for this specific patient the risk of stroke or death or coronary a carotid stent versus a carotid endarterectomy. Green shows up with carotid endarterectomy. The carotid stent is not favored in this situation, and neither is medical therapy. So we can sit down with the patient and say, this is why we're recommending what we recommend. And then we sign off on the procedure that this decision aid has been shared with the patient. So again, the patient is able to contribute. And by doing this then gets submitted to the insurer. Those of you who do procedures all know how you have to get pre-authorization to do almost anything in medicine. This now in Massachusetts, for most of our payers, suffices as pre-authorization. We've applied this now to 16 conditions, 45 different procedures. Again, most of these are high cost, high volume, or both. There's clear evidence-based guidelines and physicians' consensus We include the measurement of patient outcomes as well. And in each of these areas, we have physician champions. And so, again, we have coronary artery disease, we have spinal stenosis, herniated disc, prostate cancer, obesity, gastric bypass. Again, all of these are in the process. We're not quite there with all of them. In fact, as you can see, some are active, some are not quite there yet, but certainly that's our hope. This looks at our progress thus far in 2013 with carotid endarterectomy, with coronary artery bypass and diagnostic catheterization. So as you can see, 90% of our patients who get a cardiac cath have gone through this process. And obviously this is important because of user variability. You know, what one cardiologist will determine is something that they need a diagnostic cath versus another is tremendously variable. Again, in this situation, you can see the schema of decision making based on the various outcomes, based on stenosis, based on symptoms, and the like to help us drive our decision making. Factors that stratify the patient's risk for every one of the procedures as we move down the line. Sometimes even anatomic variants contribute to the decision making and drive, what we choose to do. This is an example of how, individual patients might be viewed. Appropriateness, and our goal is obviously, in almost all cases, to have something totally at the appropriate level. Very seldom, even in 2012, before we started this process, did we find things that were inappropriate. This is coronary artery bypass. The goal is to be all green. And this is for diagnostic catheterization. So this is a bit of a comparison of our institution with data from the state of New York, with the introduction of this process. As you can see, 85% or more of our cardiac casts are viewed as appropriate, maybe appropriate another 10%, and very, very little in the red or rarely appropriate, compared to, standard metrics coming from a state database where probably 15% of the cardiac casts might be viewed as inappropriate. So again, the goal is to do things that are appropriate, not do things just because we can do them, and not do them because we're driven by the equal to kill philosophy. I'm a general surgeon. I know there are a couple general surgeons in the room. We now apply this to various hernia repairs. Several factors that are very important to us. We look at factors related to the patient. What is the patient's preference? We consider that. Does the patient not want surgery? Does the patient strongly want surgery? Patient preferences, knowing about the risks and benefits. Is this incisional hernia repair appropriate? And then, we share the decision-making and have the patient buy into it. And each patient then, as we do this, gets their own patient-specific consent addressing specific risks as we view as important. So the whole concept really is, number one, to expand the concept of appropriateness, and second of all, to get the patient's inclusion in the decision-making process. Have them share this decision-making process, not just as a form of cost containment, but I think if the patient really understands the appropriateness and the need for the procedure, that the patient-reported outcomes in the end will be better, will provide better health care, not just to our patients, but to our health system, as well as hopefully the rest of the country. Because of healthcare reform, we have a lot of options out there. The question is, what can we really afford to do? And unfortunately, in 48 hours, I'll be back in the snow and cold of Boston. But I really appreciate everybody here for being such great hosts. Thanks to Ron. Thanks to the Sansum Clinic. Thanks to Drew. This has been a very special week for Cheryl and I. So thank you. Happy to take on any questions that come from physicians or from the light or the public. I'll go to the boss first.
Did you get a lot of pushback from people talking about cookbook medicine kind of thing with the appropriateness criteria?
The pushback has been the time. What is the time necessary to go log on and enter all these things in? Now, truthfully, many of these are done by nurse practitioners or physician's assistants. But I think honestly, if we engage our patients properly in the process, the amount of time that the surgeon has to do this is small. It isn't, the computer doesn't necessarily tell you, that it just doesn't dictate to you, but it does tell you what generally is the best option based on whether it be anatomy, whether it be previous factors, anatomic or symptomatic or the like. So I think, to be honest with you, the pushback has been time. Time is, again, the thing that we all complain about, whether it be the electronic medical record, meaningful use, whatever it is, time is our most valuable resource.
So that was exactly my question. So when you compare with this process you're using and the patient outcomes, which is taking more time and do you have better outcomes? So it's sort of a pay me now, pay me later situation, even though it may take you more time.
So again, much of the outcomes work is done within the system. The individual surgeons don't have to do that. As you all are well aware, our patients are being evaluated for their care in the hospital. They're being evaluated for their patient satisfaction in the clinics. All those things are taking place. And so unfortunately, the system, the health system, the physicians group have to invest in these very important programs. So the only real time effort really goes into the surgeons, number one, of making sure that the patients are engaged in the decision-making process, and then reading your outcomes. And if you don't look at your outcomes, one of the names that has really surfaced again over the last 10 years is the name of Dr. Codman. Dr. Codman was a surgeon at the NJH 100 years ago, and he, at that time, preached the value of outcomes. And he was basically driven out of the NJH because nobody wanted to talk about outcomes. Nobody wanted to report their successes and failures. And now he's heralded as being this great visionary 100 years later. And he was one of the people who helped the American College of Surgeons get started. He helped form the Joint Commission of Hospital Accreditation, not an organization we all love, but he really was a pioneer. And is really recognized now for his contributions. So, over here.
I wasn't sure whether the experience you report is basically a response to the Massachusetts plan, which is a little older, or to the Affordable Health Care. And is there a significant difference between the ideas encompassed in Affordable Health Care as compared to Massachusetts?
So, Affordable Health Care Act in Massachusetts was really about access. And it had funds available to take care of it through other forms of legislation pre-existing. So there has not been added costs to our employers or to our individuals. And what's been added on to the original act have been various layers of bureaucracy to try to control healthcare costs. Much of what we are talking about now is more focusing on the U.S. healthcare, because Massachusetts didn't really regulate the quality and safety side of it. They really provided access. And again, as you heard the politics for the decade of people talking, it was always about the percent uninsured at various states and the people who didn't have access to healthcare. And Massachusetts has taken care of that, but it's really the additions that the federal government has put on that are driving all these other things, because they're interested in paying for it across the entire country. Yes, sir.
What flexibility exists for either the patient or the doctor to disagree with everything after the computer spits it all out, and you got the red, the green, and the yellow, and the computer says do green, but either the patient or the doctor, or both, maybe wants to do the red?
This is totally non-binding. Nobody stops you from doing this. The goal is just better patient education. And again, as an ophthalmologist, you have pretty apparent outcomes. People can't see, and you make them see better. But for hernias and hip replacements, procedures that drive a lot of business, the outcome of how much better are you after you had this knee replaced, or how much better or worse are you after you had this hernia operation done, is something that is unclear. And if the patient really feels that they had some role in the decision making, we think it's almost a placebo effect, is that I know what I signed up for. And listen, I've gotten surgical consents for 30 years, and most times it's just a matter of, you need this, and this is what we're going to do, and sign here. And there are a few risks, and I'll tell you about them if you want to know. But and the alternatives were never explained. I mean, prostate cancer is the example we chose there. As you know, there are at least, as I said, 5 different therapies for prostate cancer. But if I'm tight with the urologist and all my patients end up getting a open prostatectomy versus I'm tight with radiation therapy, that's how places go. I did my training, as did you, at Johns Hopkins. And at Johns Hopkins, the word radiation therapy for prostate cancer did not exist, because Pat Walsh was such a powerful urologist that you know, radiation therapy was just stifled as an alternative. At the MGH, radiation therapy is kind of a big dog, and it is a very accepted therapy. Why is that? It's because of the power of the people, not necessarily the quality of the outcomes. Over here.
Quick question about a third into your conversation. You talked a little bit about, about quality control, and my words, but when you went as a consultant to Stanford, your breath was sort of taken away that they didn't have a QC quality control person in surgery. My question is, did you find one here in Santa Barbara? And two, if you had one, would it make outcomes, one, more transparent to everyone, the doctors and the patients? If they're good, patients like it, they tell more people, and could that drive then how people go about doing things? Because if they don't get a good outcome in surgery, maybe people do go back to other kinds of therapies.
So let me tell you what we have at the MGH. So every year I get a book this thick on all our different divisions, on all the various quality measures, whether it be length of stay, blood transfusions, patient satisfaction, skip measures, for those of us who are surgeons know what those mean. I have all that data. We have now gone to individual surgeon specific. So I have a binder this big from every surgeon, 100 plus surgeons in our group. Okay. So we have levels of bureaucracy, but people working on this quality assessment tools and providing the information to our providers so that we know what we're doing well. And you know, when I look at my outcomes and see that my length of stay is longer than my partner's for pancreatic resection, I say, you know, what am I trying to do different? We're all physicians, I think, all type A personalities, all very competitive. And if I see that, you know, my outcomes are standard deviation away from everybody else, what can I do to do it? So I'll give two examples. So I when we were at Stanford, there was not a single group like that working for the physicians within the department. Now, yes, their hospital did sign up for NISQIP, which is the National Surgical Quality Improvement Group. They see the overall outcomes from their institution, but it is not drilling down to the individual divisions or to the surgeons. And again, NISQIP only really works for general surgery and vascular surgery. They weren't doing it for all the other majors. And you know, Stanford's a pretty good institution. And just another example, just say you don't have to go all the way to the West Coast. A good friend of mine was a candidate for the chief of surgery job at Duke. And he was going to give a talk to the, he's coming from Wisconsin, he's giving a talk to the faculty about his vision and all. And he had, you know, 100 slides and all these various points about research and education and all this and all that. And I said to him, I said, you know, not once during this hour talk about your vision did you ever use the words quality and safety. And I said, you don't get a job in Massachusetts unless you're willing to focus on quality and safety, because that is such a driving factor. So if you go to North Carolina, which again isn't Massachusetts politically, isn't necessarily that far ahead of the curve, and you start being a visionary and speaking about quality and safety, people will say, you know, that person's got the right ideas. I didn't get the job, so I guess maybe I didn't help him. But to be honest, I have to say that for this to happen, I think it needs strong surgical leadership. I was very happy in Indiana. I loved Indianapolis. I had great faculty. I took the job at Boston not because it was the MJ, not because it was Harvard over Indianapolis, and certainly not because the cost of living was favorable. I took the job because I realized that I was never going to cure cancer. I was never going to win the Nobel Prize. If I could figure out how to be part of a team that could deliver quality and safety in the field of surgical care and introduce words like appropriateness, then I might have an impact that might be lasting compared to, you know, just working at the same old, more cases and more opportunities. And I would leave it to the surgeons to answer that question. I think for that to happen, you need strong surgical leadership. You need strong support of the hospital. It's tough to do with, we have an affiliated hospital with part of partner system that had private surgeons. They've actually joined our group so that we can work together. As you see, we contract together, we do a number of things. It's very tough to do in fragmented organizations. And if the hospital and the physicians aren't aligned, or if, you know, various physician groups are not aligned, it's very difficult to do. And that may be the one thing that I have detected is you haven't necessarily felt the pressure to do that yet here, but I expect it will be coming. And again, I would yield to, you know, the CMOs and the hospital administrators and the clinic administrators, because once that starts getting tied into your reimbursement and your contracting with the various payers, it will be a challenge. And you've got, you know, Kaiser and Sutter here in town that have been sort of practicing, or at least in the state, I can't say in town, but have been practicing on those fronts for a long time, and I think that's going to drive it.
Thank you.
If it's perfectly clear to everyone what he's been talking about, I'm confused. There, you can see he's a master at this. We're just still learning. But the important point I'd like to mention is quality and appropriateness have been pretty standard for this community ever since I've been here and long before I came. Documenting it and all the layers of bureaucracy to document it and put it together, to me, is what's going to actually cause more costs or higher costs to medicine than some of the other things that are proposed. But anyway, I thank Keith, and thank you all for coming, and we'll see you all next year.